story we tell, and it'll be kind of documenting the history of race.
And my name is Nadesh Nikova, and I'm the director of Program Center, and I just want to welcome you again. The first thing that I really would like to do is just take a minute and have each one of you provide us with your thoughts, your feelings, your whatever it is that you have to offer the rest of us. I know it's a lot of information, and we can take it so many different ways. But one of the things that I like you or invite you to do is think in terms of this information, this philosophy, this attitude, this way of thinking that began so long ago, and how do we bring that to today's day? How it is that our attitudes, our beliefs, and our actions as a nation, how we're still conducting ourselves, and are these sentiments still alive today? So,
I thought the film was very thought-provoking. It really,
in this country,
I was really thinking back to
Asia. I guess that I was taught. I mean, I know some things here that I was like, that would have been helpful. But my feeling is there were some moments in this film that I felt very disgusted about. And I feel like that's a very strong feeling. And deeply sad, really, because I don't necessarily feel that. In some ways, I feel like we've come a long way. In some ways, I feel like there's no change. And I just feel like
I heard it. So a lot of things that I did not know even. But Thomas Jefferson, it's interesting that in the last couple of years the book came out about Sally Hemings, the slave that he had who was mother to his children. And yet, coming forward, it's the same thing still as, so we're going to tell another country what they should do. Like in this movie where the white people make decisions for everybody that lived in the land, and I think on many very different levels that still occurs in terms of race, in terms of social standing, in terms of a country that is richer than another imposing its will. So I think it happens on very many different levels all the time still, which is very sad.
One quick expansion. I love the mention of expansion of democracy for the white American when. And I wrote that in my notes because today that is our, you know, expanding democracy, freedom to the rest of the world, and that's the flag that we use to justify our right to honor.
So a lot of people fall into the same group, but not necessarily the same race. And it talked about, you know, America being the powerful America, and it makes you think of the American dream. But in realizing that everybody just took what they wanted, and it wasn't like they really deserved it or earned it or worked for it. They just took what they wanted, and that's disheartening to know that that's how we got to where we're supposed to be.
Okay, I'm sorry. I've seen quite a few films of this nature in my lifetime, and a lot of it has, the more I hear of it, the more I am happy that things aren't the way they used to be. We as human beings have the whole idea that we're all different, but we're not. We're all came into this world in the same way. We have, the only thing that changes is our surroundings. the people who gave us life, we learn from them. However, once you leave that circle, you learn for everyone else. You see how other people interact. And if you are part of that, you from afar, you think that, I don't want to act that way. So you interpret your own being to be that way. We kind of mirror each other. If you see a blonde and you're brunette, you say, I want to be a blonde. You can't be. You can do that, but you can't be that person. You still have to be what's inside of you. And from day one, when you're born, you begin to feed the inside, the goodness inside, or the badness, depends on what you're environment. So we are just a product of our environment, our home life, our friends, our country. You know, and today we have enormous population of people coming here because they want to do better for themselves. And years ago they held on to that. The generation of my parents left Florida coming to Massachusetts for a better life. And my father held on to that. He drummed it in our heads that we're sacrificing this for you. And don't ever forget that. And so that's what is what you love about the United States. Or if you didn't get that lesson coming in years ago when you were an infant growing up and in young years, then you hate about it because you weren't given that. So it's all, but as you mature, we have our brain matures. And some people
a lot of emotions. Some that I can put my hand on, some that I cannot. I am a child that grew up in Waterford, so there's a lot of things that I had to educate myself on, being a woman of color, mm-hmm. and being in an environment where I was the minority. So this is not unfamiliar to me, plus having parents who told us about educating yourself. I think my biggest topic that I would like to even pull out of this is justification. Everything's justified. And that's half the problem. We justify our behavior because of what we've experienced. They justify what they did because of how they felt to us. Everything's justified. This began on science and politics. In order for it to end, we need science and politics to bring it into it. Real simple, from my point of view. If a scientist comes out right now and knocks out every book that ever said these people are this way, if politics would be honest and say this law does not apply.
Okay. So yes, we do live in a society where there are always ways of justifying what should be allowed to each individual. To have. If you act, there are consequences to your actions. Those consequences to those actions should be accepted, not justified, not excused. There can be explanations for this should never serve as justifications. What I want to go to is science. There is science that has come out. Tons of science that says race does not exist. In fact, this whole thing is all about that.
But it's not being educated.
Right.
I'm saying it's not being presented to the children. They're still coming and going to school, and it's not in the curriculum. It's not in the curriculum. Not one school in this area, or any area where there are people of color, is that education being given. So we have to go find it for ourselves.
And we're going to get to the point as to why that is. There is a reason why that is.
But then, I mean, I think one way to understand that is that history, for the most part, is really propaganda. And unfortunately, a great deal of science is also propaganda. And by propaganda, what I'm referring to ideas, concepts, education that is maintained for the that is presented for the purpose of maintaining the power structure. As purpose for, because history is the history of the oppressors. History is history of those that are in power and wish to continue to be in power. So they're going to manipulate the education in the broadest sense so that people believe that which is going to keep them in power.
An example of that would be President Obama's question of where it was born. I mean,
right.
Whether I subscribe to the political party or not, I mean, just the fact that that had occurred, and honestly, that there were more people outraged about that, question to me is evidence of oppression and who has power, who doesn't.
Right. And, one thing that I found very interesting was the question is, are blacks inferior to whites? That is the question I'm going to answer. Blacks are inferior to white. Now, if the question was, are blacks the same as whites? That's the question I'm going to start answering. Blacks are the same as white. So, it's going back to the manipulation. Science and history are often managed or handled or written or documented based on the cultural context of the time. And it's also who owns the resources in order to begin documenting the history or engaging in the science. So, and that's still to today, because if we look at our institutions of higher education, if we look at our power base, so to speak, those that get to make the decisions are held by a majority. And if we look at the composition of that majority, the answer is there. And that continues to be the case. You know, there were very powerful expansion of democracy. Were very powerful concepts here that were talked about, such as, again, expansion of democracy. That's something we still very much talk about today. And what are the justifications that allows us to continue doing that? The messages in the exhibit, which was interesting, that exhibit that they talked about. And what is our world of exhibits today? Where do we see most of our exhibits today? And I'm not talking exhibits like this, the news, the media. How do we portray, how do we continue to portray members of the minority communities? Actually, ironically being in a gallery, who is curating that exhibit? Who has the resources and the control and the power to African American or African descent and the white is members of people of color, minority communities in general, and then, the white, and I hate using those labels, but that is the reality. And also, I wrote for myself, the justification of beginning way back when to institutionalize, and I didn't realize until I really started writing my notes how far back this goes, the institutionalization of white privilege and the institutionalization of racism. So it's so part of the fabric of this country. Is so hard. So, going back, is there anybody else that would like to?